Philippine investors not too happy with the latest inflation print. The PSEI closes lower anew after Philippine inflation climbed in March, joining regional downswing. Value turnover was high at 14.3 billion pesos. Joining us now to assess today's trading, we have Christina Ulang, First Metro Investment Corporation. Christina, good afternoon. Welcome to the show.
Hi, good afternoon, Stanley. Thanks for having me. Happy to be here.
All right. Now, inflation for March 2024 quickened to 3.7%. Was this within your house call at First Metro? And where do we go from here?
It's within expectation. Our internal forecast was like 3.7, and we were happy it was hit, but the market is not happy. The market is disappointed because there is this resurgence coming from 2.8 last January, then 3.4, then 3.7. So it looks like there is this that this inflation story is stalling, and there is a worry that the BSP is going to be hawkish in its next meeting, which is next Monday. And the jitters are all over, showing in the value turnover and in default in the PSE. So onwards, I think what's going to be worth looking into would be the effect of some numbers like in 2023, because it's a low base effect, which is the opposite of the high base effect in the first quarter of 2023. So we saw a low inflation of like 3.3% in the first quarter of this year, mainly because of the contribution of the high base effect of 2023 first quarter inflation of about 8.3. So going into second quarter, the average inflation last year second quarter was only 6%, and so that's relatively lower than the 8.3 of the previous quarter. And then this year, the effect of that low base effect would be a contribution to the higher, most likely higher inflation. So the it seems that given all the other factors aside from the mathematical effect of the low base effect, the El Nino and then the hot wars that we are all seeing in Israel, Hamas, and then in the Red Sea and in Ukraine, and all of the price increase, then the trajectory seems to be shifting in the second quarter.
Okay.
In terms of the inflation direction.
Okay, so you mentioned, of course, that kind of progression for 2.8 in January, 3.4 in Feb, and for March, 3.7, within the target still of government's 2 to 4% range. But with the rate things are going, this could still go up. The question is, can we still catch up?
In terms of the market outlook. I think this is the time to build up your position towards the second half. The target really is the second half. This is the meaningful time for the year, because this is when we can actually see interest rates in the U.S., interest rates here easing lower in response to inflation. It's going to be policy reacting to lower inflation, It seems that the inflation journey is going to be taking a long time, which is also what's happening in the U.S., very strong and resilient U.S. economy, wage gains, low unemployment. But here we are suffering from rise inflation and oil and transport costs and electricity costs all going up. So it seems that the BSP is going to be very watchful, also very patient in terms of assessing all of the data before they start cutting rates. But our hope is that eventually interest rates will have to come down, because there is this compelling need really to eventually ease up and allow for more growth onwards. So the fine tuning is going to be very tricky on the part of the policymakers.
All right, it's important that you mentioned about interest rates remaining higher for longer, because the latest consumer print, of course, builds the case for sustained interest rate levels for the BSP, potentially moving timelines again for the cuts. And at this juncture, do you believe that really keeping those rates high, is it going to do the trick in terms of managing inflation? Because many of the threats, such as, you know, rise, you have fuel, you have El Nino, it could be addressed not necessarily through policy-related moves.
Mm-hmm. Of course, there are limits to what a monetary policy can do, but the top priority really is the currency. Without high interest rates and without being defensive in the monetary policy front, then we can all suffer from the very volatile currency, which we now seeing to be stable because the BSP has been very proactive and doing some off-cycle rate hikes prior, like months ago, last year. And then so we saw the peso even strengthen. But the flip side really is the strong dollar story. We cannot prevent the dollar from further strengthening because we're seeing some weakness in Japan, in the yen, it's very weak. The yuan of China is also very weak. When there is some weakness in the other major currencies, that seems to reinforce the strength of the dollar historically, and also add to that the very resilient U.S. economy, very strong economic data, soft landing scenario. So the currency is really very critical to our inflation scenario, inflation outcome. And I think the BSP is doing all it can to really be very defensive and proactive when it comes to interest rate management in relation to the currency. They don't want it to be like flirting towards 57 or like above 57 because it would tend to erode inflation expectation, reinforce higher inflation expectation. So I think that works also in a big way, okay. The monetary policy. But also there is the need to complement it with other measures, non-monetary measures, like keeping doing some revisit, a review of the supply chain in the Philippines. Because if you're going to look at the farm gate prices of rice and corn, basic commodities, they're so low compared to the retail prices. So what accounts for the gap between the farm gate and the retail? I think that's worth revisiting. Something is broken within the supply chain. So it's not necessarily shortage in supply, but the efficiency of the distribution that needs to be revisited.
All right. Christina, you know, a lot of agencies, a lot of bodies have sounded off the alarm when it comes to gross domestic product for the Philippines in 2024. In fact, many are recalibrating now, our very own National Economic and Development Authority doing that. Do you see sustained borrowing rates now affecting GDP as it is?
Mm-hmm. Of course, it will have an effect because we have tighter for longer credit conditions already, and loan growth may suffer, borrowing may suffer, spending may suffer. And the latest news is that the government's gonna borrow more because of the budget deficit that was raised to like 1.5 trillion coming from 1.4 trillion earlier target.
And that's already 5%. Christina, are you still comfortable with these debt levels of government?
With respect to the debt levels, we've seen the 60% of GDP. This is the measure that is being monitored by the rating agency, credit rating agency. So this is the better way of looking at the credit situation. 60%, 60.1 of GDP, the government's total indebtedness. I think that's way below. That's just on the threshold. And I think government is managing it well in terms of sustaining growth. So for next year, even though we have this fear that the tight credit condition may affect, high interest rates may affect the growth scenario, I think the fiscal position is also is still very strong in terms of support. We've seen the national government infrastructure disbursements hit 1.4 trillion last year. It was actually one of the reasons why the budget deficit was breached. And I think the PPP rollout and all of those are going to be helpful in propelling the economy onwards this year, even in the face of tight credit. So it's really important that government moves in terms of spending, complementing it, of course, with making the tax revenue collection efficient, because government has said they're not going to impose any new taxes. The funding really has to be there in order to support the the infrastructure spending and all the national government spending. And of course, the LGUs must be taught how to spend more efficiently so that the impact will be like the multiplier effects will show in the GDP. So I think there is some room to counter on the part of the fiscal to counter the negative effect, adverse effect of tight credit.
All right, lastly, and going back to the markets now, Christina, we saw 6,800 broken today. Are we entering a deeper consolidation? What is your view? Are we on our way to the 65 to 6,700? And more importantly, is the rally over?
I think this is a reaction, of course, of the market to the BSP, upcoming BSP, very cautious stance with regard to what the governor is going to say with regard
to inflation. Yeah, but we most likely they will keep rates steady. It is something that we already anticipate.
Yes. I think that's going to trap the index to this low level of 6.8, 6.7, 6.8, 6.8, 6.9, and so we're going to be like. But I think I'm hopeful that we're going to be like climbing again to 7,000. If and when the inflation reverses, if this inflation story continues and this 3.7 reverts back and corrects, I think the attempt to reach 7,000 is going to happen again.
Okay.
Hopefully.
All right. On that note, Christina Ulang, First Metro Investments Corporation. Again, thank you so much for joining us today. Happy weekend.
Thanks, too. Bye-bye.